Well, good morning. Welcome to everyone here in the building. It's great to have you with us as we come to worship God together. It's great to hear the psalmists as they worship God, a good example to us. So Psalm 98 starts like this. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvellous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. Let's come and pray and praise that God together in our prayers. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you are the God of salvation, the God who works salvation for your people. You're the one who rescues us from the coming wrath. You're the one who forgives your people, who accepts us, adopts us into your family. We've got so many reasons to praise you, to glorify you. Help us to do that this morning. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to stand to sing a song that's based on Psalm 98. So sing to God new songs of worship. All his deeds are marvellous. He has brought salvation to us with his hand and holy arm. Let's stand to praise him together. Sing to God new songs of worship, all his deeds are marvelous. He has brought salvation to us with his hand and holy arm. He has shown to all the nations righteousness and saving power. He records his truth and mercy to his people Israel. Sing to God new songs of worship. Earth has seen his victory. Let the lands of earth be joyful, praising him with thankfulness. Sound upon the harp his praises, play to him with melody. Let the trumpets sound his triumph, show your joy to God the King. Sing to God new songs of worship, let the sea now make a noise, all on earth and in the waters. Sound your praises to the Lord. Let the hills rejoice together. Let the rivers clap their hands. For with righteousness and justice, he will come to judge the earth. Please do be seated. And we're going to continue praising that God together as we pray now. Let's come before our God in prayer together. Heavenly Father and Almighty God, you are indeed the mighty one, the mighty King, majestic, clothed in splendor, clothed in light, holy and exalted. Lord, in our better moments, we get some understanding of who you are, and we wonder how it is that we can come to you, draw near to you. It's not like we're important enough, certainly not pure enough, never powerful enough. Who can bear the white hot heat of your holy gaze and live? It is only through Jesus Christ that we have access to you in him, hidden in him. He's got the right to come to you, Father. He's your son. He's the righteous one. He's lived that perfect life. No deceit found in him, no sin at all. He's your beloved, the one you have loved from before the foundation of the world. You welcome him into your presence. And it's through him, covered in his perfections, in his name, we can come to you now, every day. Thank you that he took our sin upon himself, dealt with it at the cross, and gave us his righteousness. Thank you that he poured out his Spirit upon us. What a gift that is. Thank you, you come to dwell in your people by your Holy Spirit, who drives us back to you again and again, who pushes us to pray, who gives us godly desires, who causes us to look upon you, to rely upon you. You've done everything, Lord. You've made it possible for us to come to you, the triune God, the God of love, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We thank you that you've welcomed a people to yourself at great cost, a people to yourself to join you in fellowship, to be in loving relationship with you. We praise you today once again for such love, amazing love. We praise you for the privilege you give to us that we can come to you today and every day. We praise you for abundant grace, for such goodness poured out on the undeserving. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to turn in our Bibles now to Mark chapter 8. And I've asked Leslie to come and read to us from God's Word. We're on page 844 of the Black Church Bibles. Mark chapter 8.
Mark chapter 8, beginning at verse 31. And Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels."
Thank you very much.
Jesus knew he had been sent to go to the cross. He was going to die for his people. We're going to sing again to his praise, to be reminded that my Lord, my love is crucified. We'll stand to sing, "O love divine, what have you done?" Divine, what have you done? Immortal God has died for me. The Father's co-eternal no son, bore my sins upon the tree. The immortal God for me has died. My Lord, my love is crucified. Look on him, all you passing by, the wounded Prince of life and peace. Come, sinners, see your Maker die, and say, was ever grief like his? Come, feel with me his blood applied. My Lord, my love is crucified. Is crucified for me and you, to bring us rebels back to God. Believe, believe the record true. Our lives are bought with Jesus' blood. Pardon for sin flows from his side. My Lord, my love is crucified. Then let us sit beneath his cross and gladly catch the healing stream. For him account all things but loss, and give up all our hearts to him. Of nothing think or speak beside. My Lord, my love is crucified. Please do be seated. Most months we have a report on something that we're doing in the church, that we might learn about it, that we might pray for the ministry of God here. So I'm going to ask Thomas to come up and answer some questions for us. We got questions today on kind of two related ministries. So we have leaders meetings and we have elders meetings. So could you tell us what the difference is, what happens at them? Tell us a bit about leaders meetings and elders meetings.
Yep. So leaders meetings, we kind of announce and you may see in a program of the church. And that's where elders and deacons come together. So the elders are yourself, myself, and Morris and Roger as well. The deacons are Andrew, Tibor, and Winston. So we gather together in those times, and we kind of discuss more practical matters of the church. And then elders meetings, we don't announce, we kind of do them kind of intermittently as we see fit. And there we speak more about the spiritual side of things, how to shepherd the congregation, how to shepherd people.
Excellent, thank you. So elders and deacons, they have slightly different roles, yeah, but all seeking to serve God, yeah, and the church. Meetings, why do we do it? Elders meetings, leaders meetings, why do we do that?
Yeah, so lots of people will think that we're taking minutes and wasting hours. fortunately, that's not what this church does, because I think we keep our meetings tight, and we speak only on what's necessary. We try not to kind of drone on. But meetings are important because we need to see, well, what are we doing together? We can kind of have our own ideas in our head, maybe, and kind of, oh, I need to do this. But then if somebody else thinks, oh, I need to do this, and it's the same thing, it's kind of a clash. So it's kind of helpful to come together and say, right, this is what needs to be done. This is what needs to be prayed for. Let's go out and do it.
Brilliant. So what has encouraged you recently about the meetings that we have?
I think in the elders and in the leaders' meetings, actually, the unity that we have. But not just the unity, but the fact that each elder, each deacon is very happy to be honest about their views. You know, if they're concerned about something, or they maybe disagree in a way that we're kind of planning to do something, they make it known. And that's really helpful. It's not a band of yes men, you know. I think that's really encouraging.
Yeah, that's good. Thank you. And what can we pray for? Give us two or three things that people can pray for the leaders, for the leaders' meetings, elders' meetings. What can we pray for?
So I think a prayer of thanks, first of all, for the deacons. I think people kind of think that elders run the church, and that's true to an extent. They shepherd, but deacons kind of serve practically. And we kind of forget that there are things that go on behind the scenes and that kind of thing. And they work full-time jobs. So just being able to fit the leaders' meetings in and being able to do their roles in here in the church as well, is a real prayer of thanks. But then also pray that we, as elders and as deacons, would kind of know what to do for the congregation as a whole, but also the needs of the people, the needs of individuals. Because, you know, we're human. At the end of the day, we need God's wisdom, and so we want to ask for generous wisdom from God to be able to do this work.
Thank you. While I've got you here, I've got here a piece of paper which says Bold Conference 2024. What's that about? When's that happening?
So that's this coming Saturday on the 20th, and that's from 10 till 4. And it's not a conference that is kind of for anybody to come to. It's for people who are younger, so people who are roughly 30 and under. What's quite interesting is that the people who come to the conference decides the topic of the next conference. So if you come this time, you'll be able to vote on what is talked about next time. So that's quite helpful. But I think also the topic that we're having this Saturday is helpful as well, because you may have heard lots of sermons and maybe YouTube videos and things like that on why does God allow suffering? But this takes it a little bit further. It's kind of, well, if we're God's children, if we're saved, God loves us, God has died for us, how come we still suffer as Christians? And I think that's a weightier topic again. So that's something that's really beneficial to us. We all suffer as Christians, and just seeking to understand a bit more about that. We have two speakers. There'll be a Q&A, there'll be pizza, and I believe there's some pastries as well in a break. So why not come?
Absolutely, that's brilliant. So that's this Saturday.
This Saturday.
10 to 4, yep. Young adults.
Yeah.
Do see Thomas afterwards about that, but I do encourage you to go to that. Thank you so much, Thomas.
Thank you.
We're gonna pray for that conference and for the leaders and leaders' meetings. Let's come before God in prayer now. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you that this conference is happening on Saturday. We pray for Derek Mead, who's speaking, and for Thomas, who's doing much of the speaking. Please encourage, use them, help them in their preparations as they tackle this. Such a vital subject, Lord. May you give wisdom to all involved, to everyone who's listening as well. And may it be that you'd bring along many young adults from this church, from lots of other churches in the area. And may it be that the conference would be such a opportunity for people to be built up, for Christians to grow, to love you and trust you even through the hard times. We pray that whole conference would be pleasing to you. And Father, we pray that you'd help us as leaders in the church to be pleasing to you as well. We thank you for the unity that is shown amongst the leaders, the deacons and the elders here. We're so grateful for that. We don't take that for granted. And we thank you that there is that honesty, that opportunity to talk about different understandings, different views of where to go next, what to do. Lord, please give us wisdom. Give us wisdom in the meetings, out of the meetings. Please help us to go your way, to care about going your way, to submit to you in everything. We pray that you'd be with the deacons in all of their duties, all of their practical work. We thank you for their hard work, Lord, for their commitment to this church, for all that they do behind the scenes that people just don't see and don't know about. May you bless and encourage them. Please be with the elders, Lord. Please help us to understand what you want us to do, to help us to know how to shepherd your flock, Lord, your church, to be under shepherds under the Lord Jesus Christ. And may your will be done, Lord. We commit ourselves as a whole church into your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. At this point, I'm going to ask Winston to come and give us the rest of the notices for this week. Thank you very much.
It's a special day today for a young lady, 90 years young. So congratulations to Betty celebrating her 90th birthday. If you weren't here last week, I'll put you to sign the card for her this morning, and we'll give that to her over tea and coffee. So join us for tea and coffee, and also some cake as well. Right, there's some cake there. So do sign that as we wish Betty happy 90th birthday. This week, it's a number of meetings. You've heard about meetings. Well, there's a number of meetings. Prayer meetings this week at Wednesday morning at 10:30. But there is no Bible study this Thursday because we have a church members meeting. All right? So if you're a church member, you'd have given an agenda a couple of weeks ago. There's some additional papers for you to take today. Do take it. Do read it. I encourage you to come along. It's an opportunity where members get to hear what's going on and also make decisions and just to pray about the various things. So do come along this Thursday at 7:30 for our members meeting, but there's no prayer meetings this week. And can I encourage you to, if you're able to come to our door-to-door outreach this Saturday at 3:30. Once a month, we aim to go out in a couple of roads, knock on people's doors, talk to them, invite them to the services, to the church, tell them who we are, what we believe, and just share something of the gospel to them. At our last leaders meeting, we was getting some feedback here on how the last one went, and was encouraged by the number of people who did actually open doors in the late afternoon. Some conversation that were held, people took leaflets about the Easter, so that's encouraging. So let's just continue to pray that those who do take leaflets may respond to it, but equally as we go out this Saturday. So if you think you're able to do that, if you feel a bit nervous about it or anxious, we do go out in pairs. Do come along, encourage each other in that way. And if you cannot come, then just pray for that time at about 3:30 onwards for a couple of hours. Just pray that the Lord will encourage those who are going out and will just really open the hearts and the doors of peoples who live in the locality. A couple of things. One of the things that we're continuously seeking to do is to bring the good news to the children in the area. So we do have some of these leaflets, the Good News Club. Do encourage you to take them. If you come across children, perhaps neighbours, children you talk to, parents, friends who've got young children from 5 to 11, do take some of these, do give them to them, encourage them. We want to see our work amongst the children grow. Obviously, we are concerned that we want to see more children coming in to hear the gospel. And really, children don't come on their own. Often parents have to bring them or encourage to bring them, and pray that the Lord will just really touch the hearts of the parents, that the parents may be encouraged to bring their children along to our Good News Club. So we'll ask you to do that. In a couple of weeks' time, we have our fellowship lunch on the 28th of April. Now, when we have that particular meeting, we have that particular lunch, we normally have, and we will be having, a time of just looking back of what God has done for us as a church over the last year. So it's like an annual review meeting where we just share some of the things that's been going on. You've heard little bits over the weeks. But as we just look back and say thank you to God for what he's done for us in 2023. And he's provided a lot for us, both financially, and people have been coming. We've been encouraged by various new meetings. But come and hear about that. So stay for lunch, come for lunch. It's a bring and share lunch. The idea is that you just bring a dish, and there are some notes, there's some sheets in the back hall if you want to put down if you're able to bring a dish, what sort of dish, and help. And we, Gifty and Debbie, are overseeing this meal. So if you've got any questions or queries about the meal, not too sure what to bring, is this okay, do have a word with Debbie or Gifty. All right, they're overseeing that. But there are some lists in the back hall there, which you'll be familiar with, and we look forward to that being a good time. Now, once a month, you hear from John Steele about the various missionaries that we support, and you may have picked up the last leaflet from Niven News in March 2024. If you haven't picked it up, I encourage you to pick it up and read it. It's really encouraging what's going on in Albania. Next Sunday, you have the opportunity to meet Will Niven, because he's coming over to the UK and he's preaching here Sunday morning and Sunday evening. Now, I've always been encouraged when I've heard Will speak. He's a very good speaker. So I encourage you to be here next Sunday morning and next Sunday evening as you hear about, well, presenting God's word. He may share a little bit about the ministry in the evening service. I'm not quite sure yet. But do come along next Sunday. Encourage you to come to that, and we'll live and pray that will be a really good day as he comes and spends the day with us.
Thank you, Winston. We're now going to take up our offering for our gifts to God's work. You know, if you're a visitor or a guest, please don't feel obligated at all. You can let the bags pass you by. Some of this money does, in fact, go to Will Niven, to the other missionaries we support, and others to the ministry here. We will take up our offering now. Thank you. Let's come and pray together. Let's pray. Father, we want to thank you for the money you have given to us. You're the one who's provided everything we have. There are so many blessings to be thankful for. We thank you that each good thing we have today, yesterday, during the week ahead, appoints us to heaven, to the better good to come, appointed to your abundant generosity, your kindness in providing and giving. Help us to be wise with the money, with the things you have given us. Help us to be generous ourselves. And we pray for the use of this money now, that in this church it would be used in a right way, in outreach, that it would be used in a productive, a fruitful manner, Lord, in mission. We know that this money, some of it will go to a number of different organisations and missionaries around the world. We do especially pray for Will Niven coming next week. And may you encourage him in his many ministries in Albania, in Fier and Patos and other places. May you help him as he prepares for travelling, and may you keep him safe and his wife also. We pray that it would be an encouragement to us all next week. Father, we want to pray for the rest of the world at a dangerous time in our world. Please, may you bring restraint to those in the Middle East. We think of the attacks from Iran on Israel. We think of the ongoing war between Israel and Palestine. Lord, so much going on, so much tension. We think of the involvement of other nations, the US, our own nation as well. We can see just the potential for worse and worse disaster. But we pray that you would stop that from happening, that you'd bring peace, that you'd be merciful to all the peoples of that region. We particularly pray for Palestine at this time. May you bring relief to the people there. May you end the war, Lord. May it be that food, medicine would get through. That you'd be gracious to those who need your grace at this time. We pray that you would stop the war in Ukraine too. So difficult for us to conceive of how hard it is with bombs being dropped, with missiles coming, with power systems going down and buildings falling down. May you turn it all around, Lord. May you bring rebuilding, hope again. Lord, we pray for those closer to home as well, that you'd intervene in our lives, in the lives of those we know personally. We think of our sister at home today recovering from her op, our brother who's also recovering at home after, you know, having those blood clots and taking the medication for that. Help him to cope with that all and the side effects too. For our brother at home with the kidney stones, Lord, grant that the kidneys would be undamaged, grant that the pain relief would be effective, that the appointments tomorrow would go well. And there are others, Lord, facing long-term health problems, who are struggling with pain of one kind or another, with uncertainty. May you grant that each one would be able to trust you, to know that you are sovereign over their particular situation. You know what's going on. You know what will come as well. Help each one to trust you more and more. May you bring relief and joy even in the midst of this. Father, we also want to pray for the children of the church as they're about to go out to Sunday school and to creche. May you bless all of those things that are going on there. May those children grow up to know that you are Lord, that you are the King, that your Son is the one to trust and to follow, to live for. May you have mercy on each one, Lord. May you save the children, bring them into your kingdom. Father, we would love more children to come to the Good News Club. We pray for those leaflets that individuals here would be able to give them out, that perhaps in the week ahead as we seek to give them out to a local school, that would work out, that as we give them out in the neighbourhood again, that children, that families would see that this is good, to hear about Jesus, to hear the truth. May it be a thriving ministry once again, Lord. We pray for Yo-Yo too. We thank you for the young people who attend there. We pray they continue to be faithful and enjoy that and learn and take it on board and see the truth of it, how important this all is. May you bring others along to the teenage work as well. We commit it all to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as the children do go out for their activities, we're going to sing a song of praise, that God has been so good to us, that any good that we have is all down to him, to his grace. Anything that we do is because of him. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. It's he that does the good work and gives us the good things. What I'd like you to do during the singing of this song, praise God and look at all the different blessings that are mentioned in the song. See if you can think about how many different blessings there are of being a Christian that are mentioned in this song as we praise God together. Let's stand to sing. What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give.
my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forgiven, for by my side the Saviour, He will stay. I labour on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will defend me through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. All the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Please do be seated. We come now to our Bible reading, John chapter 11. We're on page 898. If you've got one of the black church Bibles, page 898, John chapter 11 from verse 45, as we continue our series in the Gospel of John. And John chapter 11, a very famous chapter, Jesus has raised Lazarus from the dead. What will be the reactions of the people as they see this, as they hear about this truth, that Jesus has raised someone from the dead? Let's hear God's word, John chapter 11 from verse 45. Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. So the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered the council and said, "What are we to do? For this man performs many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." But one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish." He did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. So from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. Jesus therefore no longer walked openly among the Jews, but went from there to the region near the wilderness, to a town called Ephraim, and there he stayed with the disciples. Now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and many went up from the country to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. They were looking for Jesus and saying to one another as they stood in the temple, "What do you think, that he will not come to the feast at all?" Now the chief priests and the Pharisees had given orders that if anyone knew where he was, he should let them know so that they might arrest him. Well, keep that open in front of you. Let's pray. Let's ask for God's help. And Lord, we know, Lord, that we need your help. I need your help. We all need your help to hear from you, to hear what you are saying to us today. Please help us by your Holy Spirit to understand, to apply your word to us. In Jesus' precious name, amen. So you can't say, "Oh, if I saw a miracle, then I'd believe." Jesus has just made a dead man live. So verse 45, not a surprise. Many therefore believed in him, but others do not believe. They know he does miracles. No one alive at the time was denying that. Look at verse 47 with me. Verse 47, and as we read this, remember that these are his enemies. These are the people who are about to plan to kill him. So the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered the council and said, "What are we to do? For this man performs many signs." They know. Plenty of people saw the miracles and refused to follow Jesus. They did not put their trust in him. Why not? Why not? Now, there are lots of ways of answering that question. Verse 48 gives us one of them. Verse 48, and here our place refers to the temple. Verse 48, if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. You see what they're saying? You know, if everyone believes in this Jesus, you know, what are they going to do? They're going to start saying he is the Messiah. What if they rise up in revolt against our Roman occupiers? You know what will happen then. The Roman armies will crush us. Any authority the Romans let us have will be utterly taken away. We'll lose it all. Power, prestige, position, we'll lose it all. That's a big reason why people refuse to believe in Jesus, refuse to trust him as Lord, even when they know he's a miracle worker, more than a mere preacher. Even when they know he's someone from God, they choose not to follow him for fear of what they will lose. Imagine a member of that council, chief priests, Pharisees, others there, and they're thinking, should I trust Jesus as Lord? Now, they know Jesus performs miracles. This member of the council, this imaginary member, he's heard from reliable witnesses that Jesus has raised someone from the dead. The guy walked out of his tomb 4 days after he died. But that member of the council is thinking, I don't want to give up this position. I like this influence. I like the fact that people, you know, acknowledge me in the streets. I want people listening to me, not to anyone else. And I want to be in charge of my own life. I don't want to have to listen to him. I don't want to go his way. And isn't that the problem with being a Christian? We heard it read earlier. Jesus said, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. It means putting Jesus in charge, doesn't it? A new boss. You have to hang a sign around your neck saying, under new management. There's fear in that. What will that involve if you actually submit to Jesus as Lord? The new lifestyle, having to stop one thing and start another thing? No, but we want to hang on, don't we, to the way we live now. We want to carry on with, well, it'll be different for different people, with the drinking or the selfishness or the maybe the sleeping around. What if becoming a Christian means breaking up with that girlfriend or that boyfriend? And we want to hang on to the money like the rich young ruler. We like that. Or we want to keep spending time on the gaming or the sports more than we want to follow Jesus and go his way. And then, what will the family say? You know, if we suddenly start coming, well, twice on a Sunday or midweek because we actually want to hear what our Lord says, what will our colleagues say if we stop the swearing, we stop joining in the crude jokes? There's a film called A Few Good Men. And one soldier explains his devotion to his fellow soldiers in his unit. The unit is a small group within the bigger group called the Corps. And this is the code he lives by. Unit, Corps, God, Country. That's the order of allegiance for him. But Jesus will never accept anyone being above him. No one should be weightier in our thinking than Jesus Christ, our Lord. So some might say, I don't know, oh, I'm a Kenyan first and a Christian second, or I'm a member of the team first and a Christian second, or I'm a husband or a mother first and a Christian second. But Jesus is saying you cannot be a Christian if you think you're a Christian second to anything. And that's scary stuff, isn't it? Fear is not altogether unreasonable at this point. The Lord is calling us to a complete turnaround, to a whole new direction. Consider the fears of these Jewish leaders here, yeah? The Romans are going to take away our place and our nation. That term, our place, let's just check that. Acts chapter 6, verse 14. Some people were accusing Stephen, saying, Stephen, this is what he's been teaching. We've heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place. It's referring to the temple there as well. And we'll change the customs that Moses delivered to us. One British preacher said this, Jewish identity was tied to their worship and their land. That's where Jewish identity was. So Jesus was challenging the very foundation of their identity, the things they relied on for safety and security. You know, becoming a Christian, trusting Jesus as Lord, denying yourself, that feels like a challenge to your very identity. For example, Rosaria Champagne Butterfield, English professor, LGBT advocate, she became a Christian. But before she did, she began asking questions in her head like this. When she was thinking about Christianity and Jesus' claim on her life, she was thinking, who would I be without my lesbian identity? Am I losing my mind? She said, I fought with everything I had. I did not want this. I did not ask for this. I counted the costs and I did not like the math on the other side of the equal sign. Fear about losing your identity is understandable, isn't it? Fear when someone else takes control. That's a reasonable fear, isn't it? Jesus himself said we should count the cost. And fear of what you would lose is part of the equation. Now the council, they take the advice of their high priest Caiaphas, who's got a solution to this problem. He's got a solution to this fear. Do you fear what will happen if we admit that Jesus is Lord? He is the Messiah. He is the chosen king. Well, the solution is to get rid of him. Let's hear what Caiaphas has to say. Hear it from his point of view as we read it. Well, leave aside the deeper meaning for the moment. Listen to the political realism he espouses. Listen to verse 49. But one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, you know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish. You know, look at all this danger of change, all this potential loss of status, a threat to our very identity as a nation. We can make it go away. We can make him go away. Better that one man die, that many should suffer. Better we get rid of Jesus than that we lose our own power and prestige. You can see in verse 53, they went along with his proposal. Verse 53. So from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. One commentator called it, well, they began holding meetings for messianic murder. Now that's all part of God's plan. You know, they could never kill God's Messiah without God allowing it. But you don't have to kill Jesus to get rid of him. Maybe you too have a fear of following Jesus, a fear of what it'll mean for you. But you can get rid of Jesus in a number of different ways. In this day and age, you can stop listening altogether. The world will quite happily provide 100 safe spaces where Jesus is never mentioned. You can go away from this place, never come back, and find lots of places where you'll never hear his challenge again. I guess, though, for some of you, that's going to upset the family if you stop coming to church. And for others of you, you do enjoy church. You love the music or the chance to be with people, the fellowship. There's lots of good things here, whatever the reason. But you can keep coming to church and still get rid of Jesus. How? Well, you can listen, but never do. You can let the words flow over you and take no action at all. You can never repent, never turn around, never go his way. It's quite effective. You can still look vaguely respectable. You can even pretend to be a Christian, but deny yourself. Trust him with your whole life. Obey Jesus. You can still avoid all of that. Or you can place yourself on the throne. You know, you can judge Jesus rather than listen to Jesus. You know, when you hear things from the Bible, you can judge it, measure it against the standards in your own head. You know, you can choose to belittle it, disagree with it, take bits and ignore the rest. Ignore the voice of God. Maybe getting rid of Jesus in some of these ways is the solution you like. Because Jesus is serious. He wants all of you. He commands you to deny yourself and follow him. Fear of what you would lose is part of the equation, but it's only part of the equation. For example, those who turn around to trust Jesus as Lord, what they gain far outweighs what they lose. You get eternal life. That is forever joy, pleasures forevermore at the right hand of God. You get purpose and direction. You know, instead of making it up, guessing what matters to you, and then finding it kind of fades over time, you get to join in the mission of God in this world. You get to have meaning in life. That's a new identity that lasts forever. There's hope in the hard times. This is only for Christians. God only promises this for Christians. But he says that all things work together for good for those who love him. You know, even the hard times we can have hope in, not just for the future, as beautiful as heaven is, but even now that he's working it out for good. And you don't lose yourself when you become a Christian. You're still you. You are made by God. But the Lord shapes you to be a better you. And you do get that richer, that deeper identity in Christ, a child of God. Now, that's an identity that doesn't shift or fade or fall apart. You might think my identity is this, this is what I do. And then one day you can no longer do it. But a child of God, you'll always be that way. It's an identity that lasts. There's forgiveness for sin. You can leave the shame behind. You can know you're fully accepted by God in spite of all you've done and said and thought. And you gain security and peace. You know, we've been talking, haven't we, about fear of losing things. But being a Christian means you never lose what is most important, the love of God for you. The relationship with the Father, you cannot lose it. Not even death takes it away. It only makes it better. What a destiny that is. Now, that is not an exhaustive list. Why don't you think of what you would add to the list? the blessings of being a Christian. It's so much better than whatever you could lose. Why don't you tell someone afterwards, well, this is what I would add to the list, the blessings of being a Christian. Now, as well as remembering how good it is to follow Jesus, even in this life, we also need to realise that putting what we want above what God wants is sin. It's the very definition of idolatry, loving other things more than God. When you say, well, I don't want to lose my easy life. I want to keep my pleasure and my reputation. You're also saying, I prefer those things to knowing God. I love those things more than I love God. And that's sin, that's rebellion. That's Garden of Eden stuff, isn't it? I don't trust you, God, to look after me. I'd rather go my own way. I'd rather disobey you, God. I'll grab the fruit. I'll be my own boss. It's rebellion. It's idolatry. And that leads to judgment and punishment. They were cast out of Eden, away from the presence of God. And you'll be kept out of heaven if you keep saying, I fear to lose this. I love this more than I love you, God. Yeah, it's a bad bargain to keep chasing the things of this world, to keep hanging on to the things of this world and not turn to God. Again, we read the Lord Jesus saying earlier, for what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? It's not me saying that. It's not the church saying that. It's Jesus Christ saying that, the one who raised the dead. The one whose own enemies couldn't deny the miracles he'd done. The one who knows what he's talking about. Yes, there is fear of what we might lose when we become a Christian. But when we see clearly, we begin to see that love of other things is sin. It's rebellion against a good God. And clinging to those other things that we love in this world will drag us down to hell. But the one who warned us of hell is also the one who came to die in the place of sinners to escape that judgment, so that we might escape. John, he's writing this gospel, isn't he? The author of this gospel. He points out that what Caiaphas said has a deeper meaning, a meaning that Caiaphas did not intend. Look at verse 49 again. But one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, you know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish. He did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. So for Caiaphas, the solution is get rid of Jesus. Kill him. Better that we just get rid of one man instead of the whole nation perish under the Romans. We kill him so the Romans won't kill us. Substitute Jesus for us. Now, Caiaphas is talking politically. He wants to save his own skin, his own position. But the Lord has a better, a bigger plan. It still involves Jesus dying. That's part of God's plan for us. But it also involves Jesus being a substitute for the people, for his people, a kind of sacrificial language that Caiaphas is using as he unwittingly prophesies what will happen. Now, Caiaphas, high priest, he knows about sacrifice. He's there in the temple regularly with the animals being killed. It's Old Testament stuff, isn't it? An animal dies in the place of the worshipper. Any worshipper's a sinner. We've all chosen other loves above God. It's spiritual adultery, that is. It's idolatry. It's rebellion against the good king. It deserves death. But the animal dies in the place of, as a substitute for the worshipper. And yet, it's an animal. The blood of animals is never equivalent to human beings made in the image of God. The blood of animals can never take away sin. It's just a symbol, pointing forward to the better sacrifice. And well, John's already mentioned it in his gospel, where John the Baptist, a different John, sees Jesus approaching and cries out, behold, the Lamb of God. That's Jesus. He's the the animal, as it were, to be, but not just, he's the God-man to take our place, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, the substitute in the place of sinners at the cross. You know, Caiaphas, he's got a solution, but he's still rejecting Jesus, continuing to rebel against God and in his sin. But God has got a solution which cleanses us from sin, brings forgiveness, deals with our rebellion. Think about how good this is, this substitute, this swap. We're the ones who are sinners. It's our sin in the picture. At this point, does Jesus deserve the judgment of God? No, he's pure, he's innocent. He has never sinned. At this point, we deserve the punishment. It's our sin upon us, and God can see it in each of us. But when Jesus dies on the cross, he takes our sin upon himself. He's being punished by God, not for his own sin. It's our sin that's on him. He's taking the place of the condemned criminals. He's a substitute. And now, for those who trust Jesus, there's no sin on us. We're accepted, we're forgiven. There's no sin on us. It's been put on Jesus instead. French writer Henri Barbusse tells of a conversation overheard in a trench full of wounded men during World War I. One of the men, who knew he'd only got minutes to live, said to one of the other men, "Listen, Dominic, you've led a very bad life. Everywhere you're wanted by the police, but there are no convictions against me. My name is clear. Here, take my wallet, take my papers, my identity, take my good name, take my life. And quickly, hand me your papers so that I may carry all your crimes away with me in death." The wanted man swaps places with the innocent man, and the wanted man goes free. What love is this that pays so dearly that I, the guilty one, may go free? It's amazing love. I do want you to be clear that following Jesus involves change, big change, a turning around. He means it when he says you have to deny yourself. You need to stop saying yes, Lord, to yourself and start saying yes, Lord, to him. And that, if we understand it clearly, that is a frightening thing. But remember the other side of the equation. What you gain far outweighs anything you may lose. Eternal life, direction in life, security, true peace. And remember that, in fact, what you may lose, what you've been chasing after, what you want more than what God wants, that is sin. There are consequences to sin. You will lose your soul. There is a judgment to come. And God's love is so great that he offers his son as an escape from that punishment. He sends his son to the cross. It's free to us, but it cost him everything. He died in the place of sinners who trust in him. It is only for those who trust Jesus. It's only for those who trust him with their lives, enough to deny themselves. Can you say that you trust him that much to hand over the remote control of your life to him? Can you trust him that much? Well, he is exactly the right person to trust. Even with your dreams and your future and your daily life, you know, think about in this passage his control of the situation. The enemies of Jesus are plotting his destruction, but God arranges it so that the very words used to call people to reject Jesus are the words that predict that Jesus will save sinners by dying in their place. You know, the villain becomes a prophet. The enemy preaches the gospel. Now that's sovereignty. That's control. A pastor called Stephen Cole said, "You cannot frustrate God and his sovereign purpose. You can oppose him for a time. It may seem you're succeeding. They killed Jesus. But in the end, God always wins." Isn't that the one to trust? The one who always wins? The one who's mightier than any enemy? So powerful, he uses the plans of the enemy for his purposes, for good? The one who raises the dead? Who came back from the dead after they seem to have won? The one who made you Doesn't he know what's best for you? The one who loves you enough to suffer in your place. Trusting his plans for you over your plans for you, that is wise. Doesn't God know better? Isn't he the one to trust? Another pastor called Jeremy McKean tells this story. You know, I'm often like the little kid in The Princess Bride. That's a film, great film. Remember the kid in The Princess Bride? His grandpa's reading the book to him. And it looks like Buttercup is going to marry evil Prince Humperdinck. Remember what the kid says? Wait, wait, stop, Grandpa. You read that wrong. I'm just sure of it. You're messing up the story, Grandpa. Now get it right. But his grandpa wasn't messing up the story. The kid just needed to have patience to see how it all came together. And this is exactly where we find ourselves. We don't have the big picture. We don't have all the details. We can't figure out how this all makes sense and will be worth it in the end. So what do? We shake our fists at God, saying, "You're messing up the story, God. Now get it right." So actually, the problem with God's sovereignty is really a problem with our pride, says Jeremy McKean. All of us are equally prone to think we know what is best and we know when is best. Each one of us in our arrogance questions God and thinks, "I could have come up with a better plan and storyline than this. Maybe we wouldn't put it like this or verbalize it like this." But so many times deep down we think, "God, I'm smarter than you." What is that? It's like an ant thinking it can run the universe. That is our natural human pride. But God is good at running the universe. He sent his son to die for you, to love you that much, to rescue you. He knows what he's doing. He can raise the dead. He's got a plan for you. It does involve denying yourself and following Jesus. And you can trust him that that is good. You can trust him in everything. Isn't today the right day to start trusting him as Lord? Let's pray. Help us to believe you, Father. Help us to believe your Son. You really do know what you're doing. We really can trust you. It really is good to deny ourselves and follow your Son. Open our eyes, Lord. Help us to believe you and act upon it. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a song which goes through all that God does. Jesus does for his people at every stage of life, every kind of period of life. Look out for the words trust in the middle of this song as we close praising together, singing, "Lord of our dawning, who brought us to birth, gave us your word for this sin-shattered earth, clothed us with promise of strength for our days. God of beginnings, we sing to your praise."
Lord of our noonday, in Christ.
Christ, make us strong, wise to prevail in the war against wrong, steadfast to trust you and swift to obey, serving your will in our world of today. Lord of our evening, provider and guide, lead us in triumph through paths yet untried, trusting, rejoicing, till rest shall be won, serving while waiting our soon coming sun. Then in the light of his glory and grace, we shall adore you and look on your face. Then in the wonder of faith crowned in sight, serve you forever in endless delight. And now to him who is able to strengthen us according to the gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the command of the eternal God to bring about the obedience of faith to the only wise God, be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.